Our constitutional settlement, our United Kingdom, will be firm and will be secure. Our union of nations beyond question. Our democracy robust. Our future clean, green, prosperous, united, confident, and ambitious. And that is the prize, and that is our responsibility in this House of Commons to fulfil. And to do so, we must take some immediate steps. And the first is to restore trust in our democracy and fulfil the repeated promises of Parliament to the people by coming out of the European Union and doing so on October the 31st. I and all ministers are committed to leaving on this date, whatever the circumstances, and to do otherwise would cause a catastrophic loss of confidence in our political system. It will leave the British people wondering whether their politicians could ever be trusted again to follow a clear democratic instruction. I would prefer us to leave the EU with a deal. I would much prefer it. I believe that it is possible even at this late stage, and I will work flat out to make it happen. But certain things need to be clear. The withdrawal agreement negotiated by my predecessor has been three times rejected by this House. Its terms are unacceptable to this Parliament and to this country. No country that values its independence and indeed its self-respect could agree to a treaty which signed away our economic independence and self-government as this backstop does. A time limit is not enough. If an agreement is to be reached, it must be clearly understood that the way to the deal goes by way of the abolition of the backstop. For our part, we are ready to negotiate in good faith an alternative, with provisions to ensure that the Irish border issues are dealt with where they should always have been in the negotiations on the future agreement between the UK and the EU. I do not accept the argument that says these issues can only be solved by all or part of the UK remaining in the customs union or in the single market. The evidence is that other arrangements are perfectly possible and are also perfectly compatible with the Belfast or Good Friday Agreement, to which we are, of course, steadfastly committed. My team and my right honourable friend, the Secretary of State for exiting the European Union, are ready to meet and talk on this basis to the Commission or other EU colleagues whenever, wherever they are ready to do so. And for our part, we will throw ourselves into these negotiations with the greatest energy and determination and in a spirit of friendship. And I hope that the EU will be equally ready and that they will rethink their current refusal to make any changes to the withdrawal agreement. If they do not, we will of course have to leave the UK without an agreement under Article 50. The UK is better prepared for that situation than many believe. But we are not as ready yet as we should be. In the 98 days that remain to us, we must turbocharge our preparations to make sure that there is as little disruption as possible to our national life. And I believe that that is possible with the kind of national effort that the British people have made before and will make again. And in these circumstances, we would, of course, have available the £39 billion in the withdrawal agreement to help deal with any consequences. I have today instructed the Chancellor of the Duchy of Lancaster to make these preparations his top priority. I have asked the Cabinet Secretary to mobilise the civil service to deliver this outcome should it become necessary. And the Chancellor has confirmed that all necessary funding will be made available. I will also ensure £4.2 billion has already been allocated. I will also ensure that preparing for leaving the EU without an agreement under Article 50 is not just about seeking to mitigate the challenges, but also about grasping the opportunities This is not just about technical preparations, vital though they are. It is about having a clear economic strategy for the UK in all scenarios, something in which the Conservative Party has always led the way. And it's about producing policies which will boost the competitiveness and the productivity of our economy when we are free of EU regulations. Indeed, Mr. Speaker, we will begin right away on working to change the tax rules to provide extra incentives to invest in capital and research. We will now be accelerating the talks on those free trade deals. And we will prepare an economic package to boost British business and lengthen this country's lead, which seems so bitterly resented by the benches opposite. Lengthen this country's lead as the number one destination in this continent for overseas investment, a status that is made possible, at least partly, by the diversity, the talent and the skills of our workforce. And Mr. Speaker, I also want therefore to repeat unequivocally our guarantee to the 3.2 million EU nationals now living and working among us. I thank them for their contribution to our society and for their patience, and I can assure them that under this government they will have the absolute certainty of the right to live and remain. Mr. Speaker, I want to end by making clear my absolute commitment to the 31st October date for our exit. Our national participation in the European Union is coming to an end, and that reality needs to be recognised by all parties. And indeed, Mr. Speaker, today there are very many brilliant officials, UK officials, trapped in meeting after meeting in Brussels and Luxembourg, when they could be better deployed in they're deploying their talents in preparing to pioneer new free trade deals or promoting a truly global Britain. And I want to start unshackling our officials to undertake this new mission right away. So, we will not nominate a UK commissioner for the new commission taking office on the 1st of December, under no circumstances, though clearly this is not intended to stop the EU appointing a new commission. Mr. Speaker, today is the first day of a new approach, which will end with our exit from the EU on the 31st of October. Then I hope we can have a friendly and constructive relationship as constitutional equals, as friends and partners in facing the challenges that lie ahead. I believe that is possible, and this government will work to make it so.
I think what we heard was a lot of bluster in terms of soaring rhetoric, confidence, which he says the UK has lost so much of, a sense of optimism, which he says the UK has lost so much of, and yes, a sense that if this becomes a game of chicken between the UK and the EU, that Boris Johnson is willing, as Prime Minister, to blink first, or rather willing to make Europe blink first by being ready to leave the EU if that is indeed what is necessary. He did say, though, Issa, several times that he's very much hoping not to leave the EU without a deal. But in terms of substantive policy, he didn't really give any indications as to how exactly he is going to navigate these negotiations with Europe. He has a relatively short amount of time, just a few months, in which to kind of try to turn this ship around. Three unsuccessful attempts by the former Prime Minister Theresa May to pass her bill through the Houses of Parliament. He will be wanting to try to pass his trade deal, his deal through. But the real question is, what can he change? What can he guarantee the EU will give in terms of key concessions? Up until now, what we've heard from the EU is that they're sticking to their guns. There's no real incentive for them in giving the UK an easy ride here because they worry then that there will be a sort of contagion and that other countries will want to leave the EU too, that we'll be looking at a potential Frexit or a Spexit. So in terms of specific areas where he hopes to achieve a compromise or hopes to get the EU to change course, we didn't really hear any details at all. And that will be concerning to a lot of people. And I think you heard it reflected in the very rowdy crowd and all the sort of catcalling on both sides that was going on in the House today as people really want to hear substantive specifics with regards to policy and less of what they see as bluster and bravado, Issa.
Indeed, there wasn't very much detail when it came to Brexit, not just on Brexit. He was also asked how to deal with Iran, to which he gave no answer. But Clarissa, on the question of Brexit, he did say, look, as much as we will want to have a deal, we are also making preparations, and that is the most important thing, he said, for a no deal, he says. The country is getting prepared, with, be it from the financial perspective, be it from the industry. What exactly did he say in terms of the preparations that he's already got going?
Well, you know, he outlined several areas in which he said that the UK needs to turbocharge its preparations in order to be ready to walk away from the EU with no deal, if no deal is indeed what becomes of this. But in a sense, I think what that was designed to do, Issa, was to make it clear to the EU that he is very serious about being willing to walk away. He's hoping that will give him leverage at the negotiating table. In reality, the logistics of what needs to be done to prepare for such a thing are enormous. He talked briefly about, encouraging investment, trying to solidify free trade deals. He talked about changing the tax rules to encourage more investment here in the UK. But no matter what kind of free trade deals are agreed, there is a harsh reality that many in Britain are coming around to accepting that there will be an economic blow from Brexit. And he almost seemed to be encouraging with his rhetoric for people to kind of take a stiff upper lip, prepare themselves for the possibility that there might be some tough times on the horizon, but with the idea or the promise or the guarantee that sometime in the future that the ship would steady its course and that the UK would be able to sort of reclaim its rightful role as a sort of serious major superpower. He talked about reinstating this as a golden era in Britain's history, really trying to appeal to a sense of nostalgia that I think many in the United Kingdom share, and also a sense of fatigue with the pessimism, with the ugliness and cynicism of politics, really trying to inject some optimism into this whole political discussion. But as I said before, without really giving much concrete resolution or information as to what that optimism is really based on, Issa.
Exactly. And as you and I know, we know that optimism can only last so much. He's got 98 days to actually push for a deal, to try to get a deal through. And of course, they break for summer as of today. Clarissa Ward there, our chief international correspondent outside 10 Downing Street. Thanks very much, Clarissa. I'm joined now by Niall Gardner. Niall, you and I were talking yesterday looking ahead to who would take the new leadership. We're now on Boris Johnson, obviously, is a new leader. You have listened to what he had to say. To me, and Clarissa touched on this a bit here, lots of bluster, lots of hyperbole, lots of optimism, which she's right, a lot of people want to hear, but not many details.
Yes, I mean, I think at this stage, Boris Johnson is presenting the big picture, really, and it is certainly what he does best, actually. He is a relentlessly optimistic politician. He's a big picture thinker. He's a visionary. He likes to base his whole approach upon Winston Churchill. Johnson sees this as a historic moment for Britain, about to leave the European Union and once again be a truly free sovereign nation. So he's outlined this morning the big picture, some policy details on immigration issues, tax issues, for example.
Australian style
Exactly. But certainly on Brexit, I think the detail is certainly going to be outlined by his new administration. And he does have an overwhelmingly pro-Brexit cabinet.
Indeed,
in
and
place.
I think we've got the graphic up that we can show our viewers, because he's got real change of the guard, isn't it?
A major cleanup of the cabinet.
It
certainly is. Yeah.
But there it is. As you can see, this is the new cabinet. And if we just show our viewers, just in terms of numbers, how many were left or jumped or pushed, so people get a real sense. We've got two graphics to show you here. But talk to us a bit about his new cabinet. There we go. 31 ministers. There are a lot of Brexiteers, many who think like him, also some Remainers, though.
Yes, it is a mixture of Brexiteers and Remainers. But the significant thing about this cabinet is that every single member of this cabinet is 100% committed to Brexit. They're also 100% committed, in theory, of course, to a no-deal Brexit, if indeed Britain has to leave without a deal. And Boris Johnson made sure that every single person who came on board was committed to the potential no-deal Brexit. That's a huge change from the Theresa May government.
She tried
Theresa May was not willing to go down the no-deal route.
She was trying to appeal to everyone.
Yes, exactly.
Given that the referendum was, of course, it did win, but it was tight nevertheless.
Yes, and you have the three key figures in the cabinet. So Sajid Javid, the Chancellor, Dominic Raab, the Foreign Secretary, Priti Patel, the Home Secretary. These are all very strong Brexiteers, although Sajid Javid did vote Remain.
Remain.
But he has since become a very, very robust Brexiteer. So those three figures are crucially important here and will be the sort of Praetorian guard around Boris Johnson as the new Prime Minister. And I expect that when Boris says that Britain is going to leave the EU on October 31st, deal or no deal, I think he 100% means that. And this really matters. So he's really put the EU on notice here. And this is a wake-up call to the European Union. Brexit is real. It's going to be a reality on October 31st.